Right, so today's topic of discussion is arrays. Why we use arrays, where we use arrays, we'll discuss today. Okay, so till now, up to the loops, we have used only fundamental data types like char, int, long, float, double, etc. Okay, and these data types, when we use with some variable, okay, so we can store only one value at any given point of time. Okay, if you declare a variable of type int, or if you declare a variable of a type float, okay, so in that memory will be allocated and we can store only one value at any given point of time. Okay, so if we consider an example where I declare a variable called a with a data type int and I assign the value 5 to a. Okay, so when we initialize the variable this way, what happens? First, the memory is allocated for a, and 5, the value 5 will be stored, and this memory location is identified by the compiler with the name a. Yes or no? Okay, so then after some point of time, if you say a is equal to 100, that means if you assign 100 to a, okay, so what happens then? This 5 is gone and the new value 100 will be stored in a. Okay, so that means what is happening here? With these fundamental data types, we can store only one value at any given point of time. Afterwards, if you say a is equal to 200, and this 100 will go, and 200 will be stored in this variable. Okay, so like this, we can store only one value at any given point of time. But in real-time applications, okay, we need to handle large amounts of data, like students' data if you want to handle, employees' data if you want to handle, okay? So it contains a more than one value, okay? So that means a group of data we need to handle, okay? In such case, we cannot declare variables of that size, okay? So we need a data type which can handle such a large volume of a large amount of a data. Okay, so fortunately, C supports a derived data type known as array. Okay, so which can be used to for such a application. That means if you want to handle large amounts of data. Okay, so C language provides a constructor which is called as derived data type and whose name is array. Okay, so with the help of array, we can handle large amounts of data. Okay, so please remember, okay, whenever we want to handle large amount of data, that means more than one value. Okay, so a group of data, whenever we want to handle, then we'll go for an array. Okay, right. So how we can define an array? An array is a fixed size, sequenced collection of elements. Elements of which type? Elements of the same data type that share a common name. Okay, so up to previous programs, the general practice is when we want to store two values, we declared two variables like int a comma b. Okay, if we want to store three values, we declared three variables like int a comma b comma c. Okay, but when we want to store 50 values, when we want to store 100 values, then we cannot go for a 100 variables declaration. Okay, we can do, but managing these 100 variables is difficult. Okay, so what we need is, we need a single variable which can store all these 100 values. Okay, so such variable is called an array. Okay, so if you look into the definition of array, array is a fixed size. The size of the array is fixed. Okay, so that means we need to give how size of the array, we need to provide size of the array, how many elements we are going to store. Okay, so that's why it is fixed size. Sequenced collection, that means the elements, say 100 elements, they are stored in a sequence. That means one after the other, these elements will be stored. Collection of elements of which type? Same data type. Please remember, array, in array, we can store elements of the same data type. Okay, so that means all the 100 elements must be integer type, or all the 100 elements must be floating point type or double type or character type. Okay, so only same data type elements can be stored in an array, and all these elements share a common name. Okay, so that means all of them share a single variable name which is called array name. Okay, right. So array can be used to represent a list of numbers. Okay, so when you have a list of numbers or a list of names, to store. Okay, so then we go for this array. Okay, so and the arrays are classified into different types. In C language, we can classify the arrays into one-dimensional arrays, two-dimensional arrays, and multi-dimensional arrays, three and more. Okay, but we stick to one-dimensional and two-dimensional arrays in the first year. Okay, so we'll discuss about one-dimensional arrays and two-dimensional arrays. Okay, so the arrays are classified into one-dimensional arrays, two-dimensional arrays, and multi-dimensional arrays. Okay, right. So we'll begin with one-dimensional arrays. So how we can define a one-dimensional array? A list of elements can be given one variable name using only one subscript, and such a variable is called a single subscripted variable, or we can also call it as a one-dimensional array. Okay, so if you define a variable using only one subscript, and then that variable is called a one-dimensional array. Okay, example, this one-dimensional array concept is not new. Okay, so it is derived from mathematics already. We might have seen in mathematics, to represent a vector of numbers, we write like this. Say for example, V is equals to like this, 11, 22, 33, 44, 55. Okay, so this is a vector of 5 numbers. Now we'll say that V is a vector of 5 numbers. How we represent each element of this vector? Okay, like the first one, element V1, the second element V2, the third element with the notation V3, fourth element V4, V5, like this, using this notation, we represent individual elements. V1 represents first element. Okay, so here, this V1, that one which we are writing at the below, that is called the subscript here. In mathematics, we call it as a subscript. And here, only one subscript we are using. One subscript we are using. This is called single subscripted variable. Okay, so if the same concept we want to implement in the programming, okay, so then we use a one-dimensional array. We use a one-dimensional array, okay. So, for example, if we want to store a set of 5 numbers, even set of numbers also you can take, vectors or set of numbers, okay. Say for example, I have a set containing 5 numbers, 10, 20, 30, 40, 50. Okay, so I want to represent this set in a program. In C programming, how I can represent this? Okay, so for that, we may declare an array variable in this format. Okay, so data type, what type of numbers they are? Integer type. So int, and my array name is num. And now the variable name follows a set of square brackets. Okay, so this set of square brackets is called dimension in programming. We call it as a dimension. So I am using only one set of square brackets. That's why it is called one-dimensional array. Okay. So num and inside the set of square brackets mention how many elements we want to store. Okay. Because I have 5 elements in my set. So I declare a variable, one-dimensional array variable, in this way. Int num of 5. Okay. So this is how the mathematics can be represented in the programming using array variable in this format. Okay, so we'll go in deeper into the one-dimensional arrays. Okay, so declaration of one-dimensional array, how we can do this in C programming. Okay, and please remember, array is also a variable. Like any other variable, arrays must be declared before they are used. Okay, so why we are declaring variables? So that the compiler allocates enough space, enough memory for them in main memory. Okay, so enough storage locations for them in the memory. For that, we need to declare all the variables, including array, at the beginning of our program. Okay, so if you look into the general form of a one-dimensional array declaration, okay, so it is in this form. Okay, so first we write the data type, then give a space, then followed by array name, and within the square brackets, give the size of the array, and end this declaration with a semicolon. Because it is a declaration, it should end with a semicolon. Okay, so this is the general form of a one-dimensional array declaration. Here, this data type specifies the type of elements, what type of elements we are going to store in the array, that is indicated by this data type. And for example, you can take in place of data type like int, float, char, double, etc. Any fundamental data type we can use in this place. Then array name means like any other variable name, we can declare array name here. Okay, because array is also a variable, like all the rules applied to declaration of variables are applicable for array name also. Then size indicates maximum number of elements that can be stored in the array. How many elements you are going to store, that information must be given to the compiler so that the compiler allocates enough storage locations for this array. Now, if we take an example, int, I want to store age of students in a class. Okay, so then I declare an array variable like this, int, then age. My array name is age, and within the square brackets, give the size of the array 50. Okay, assume my class contains 50 students. Okay, so then here, this declaration, okay, so it declares age to be an array containing 50 integer numbers. That means we can store 50 integer numbers inside this array variable called age. Okay, now using your single variable name, now you are able to store 50 numbers. Okay, and this variable is called a one-dimensional array. Clear? If you want to store salaries of employees in an organization, then we can declare another one-dimensional array in this form. Okay, because salaries generally will be in floating point type. Okay, so that's why the data type I take as float, and my array name is salary, and within the square brackets give the size of the array as 100. Okay, assume my organization contains 100 members. Okay, so then I can store 100 employee salaries in this array by name called salary. Okay, so this declares salary to be an array containing 100 floating point numbers. 100 floating point numbers I can store in this variable called salary. Clear? So this is how we declare a one-dimensional array. Okay, so the general form of one, you need to remember the general form. Once you remember the general form, then you can use in any program and you can declare a one-dimensional array using that general form. Okay, right? Syntax, you must remember the syntax. Okay, and please remember this declaration should end with a semicolon, right? Now, what happens when we declare an array, age of size 50, salary of size 100? Okay, so internally what happens? That means you are declaring to the compiler, my array name is here age, where I am going to store 50 integer numbers. This is what you are conveying to the compiler. Then what compiler does inside? Okay, so that means it allocates, we said that for all the variables it allocates memory. Okay, for this array also it allocates memory. Okay, how memory is allocated for this array we need to understand. Okay, all memory related concepts we need to understand, then only we can use these arrays inside the program efficiently. Okay, now, when we declare an array like this, say I'm taking a small number here, int num of 5, ending with a semicolon. Okay, so if we declare an array num with a size 5, how the memory is allocated, just see here. Okay, so computer, what it will do, it reserves 5 storage locations in this form like this. Okay, so now a bunch of memory containing 5 storage locations will be allocated in this way. And now this entire memory is a single memory, please remember. But now in this, we can store 5 elements. We can store 5 integer numbers. And this entire memory is accessed by the name called as a num. Now this entire block of memory will have a name called as a num. Okay, but it is not a single value in the inside this memory location. Okay, so that means there are different elements present in this. That means we need to access individual elements. Okay, so for that, what they did is C language developers they provided a mechanism called accessing individual elements by using an index. Okay, so the first element index starts with a 0, the second element index starts with a 1, and next element at 2, next element at 3, and next element at 4. Okay, so this is called a array index. By using this index mechanism, now we can access individual elements. Clear? Okay, so how we can access individual memory locations, just try to understand here. Now we declared a int num of 5. Okay, so when we declare int num of 5, now for 5 elements memory is allocated in this form. This is what we said, and this memory block is given the name or identified by the computer with the name called a num. Okay, now individual memory locations, how we can access? Now see here, the first memory location is accessed as num of 0. Okay, so the variable array name followed by within the square brackets give the index of the first element. What is the index of first element? 0. Okay, so that means the first memory location, now this is the first memory location. Okay, so it is accessed by using the notation num of 0. Okay, so that means num of 0 indicates this first memory location. See here, red arrow showing this memory location. Okay, so this memory space now we can access using this notation num, and within the square brackets index of a first element 0. Num of 0 indicates this memory location. Okay, similarly second memory location is accessed as num of 1. Now see, this is the second memory location. Okay, so it is accessed by using the notation num of 1. Then third memory location as num of 2. This is third memory location, and it can be accessed as num of 2. And this is fourth memory location, num of 3 here. Okay, and it can be accessed as num of 3. And the fifth memory location is num of 4. This is fifth memory location. Now it can be accessed as num of 4. Now using this array indexing method, now we can access individual elements of the array. Clear? This is very important, how individual elements of an array are accessed. Okay, they are accessed using array index method. This is called as using array index notation, we call. Clear? Right? Now when we declare an array int num of 5, okay, so for 5 elements memory is allocated, and initially garbage value will present in these memory locations. Okay, now we need to store the actual values into these memory locations. Okay, so how we can assign the values to the array elements? We can assign values to the array elements using assignment operator. There are two values. Using assignment operator you can assign, or if you want to enter the values through keyboard you can use a scanf function also. Okay, so I'll show you both methods to assign values to array elements. Okay, so first one, using assignment operator we can store the elements in this form: num of 0 is equal to 10. Okay, since this is assignment statement, it should end with a semicolon. And if you write a statement like this, num of 0 is equal to 10, that means what you are instructing the compiler, please store the value 10 in the memory location of num of 0. Where is the memory location of num of 0? This is the memory location of num of 0. So in this, now the value 10 will be stored. Previously there was garbage value. Now the value 10 will be stored in this memory location. Okay, then num of 1 is equal to 20. Okay, that means please store 20 into the memory location num of 1. This is num of 1. Okay, so now 20 will be stored. When this statement is executed, 20 will be stored in a location num of 1. Okay, then num of 2 is equal to 30. If you say, then 30 will be stored in a num of 2 in this format. Then num of 3 is equal to 40. If you say, and this is num of 3, then 40 will be stored here. And when you write a statement num of 4 is equal to 50, where is num of 4? This is num of 4. Okay, so here 50 will be stored. Okay, now this way, using assignment statements, we can store values into the array. Individual values we can store into the array. Okay, right? This is first method. Directly we can use assignment statement and we can store values into the array in this format. And if we want to enter different values through keyboard, then we can use a scanf function in this format. Okay, now see, this is our array containing garbage values. Okay, how we can use scanf function? Now see here, for example, I need to declare a variable, because whenever we want to enter through keyboard, we see here five elements, five scanf functions you can write. But if you have 100 elements, 100 scanf functions will you write? No. So in such case, what happens? Repeatedly you have to read using a single scanf, and whenever there is a repeated operation, we can use a loop. Okay, so this should come into your mind. Okay, so using a for loop and scanf function, now you can read any number of elements into the array. Okay, just see here how this piece of code reads elements into the array. Okay, so step by step, I'll show the execution and what is happening inside. Try to understand here. Okay, now, so we need to write a small piece of code in this form. So declare a variable, loop control variable I here. Okay, so then ask the user to enter five numbers, because we need to give message to the user how many numbers he has to enter. Directly I said enter five numbers. Okay, so then using this for loop, for I is equal to zero, because array indexing begins with zero, you have to start your loop from zero onwards. So I should start from zero, and I less than five, I plus plus, then use a scanf function here, scanf percentage d comma address of num of I. You have to use the notation called as a num of I, because every time I value is changing. That's why we can store different elements in different memory locations using this single for loop. Okay, so how it stores, we need to understand. Okay, now when this piece of code is executed, okay, so what is happening and how elements will be stored into the memory location, just see here. Okay, now see the execution carefully, observe the screen carefully, just see here. Okay, so first what happens, this statement is executed, int I. When this is executed, for I, memory is allocated. Okay, 4 bytes of memory is allocated, and initially garbage value will present in this memory location. Okay, so then next, this statement is executed, enter 5 numbers. So on the screen you will see enter 5 numbers. Immediately what the user will do, user enters 5 numbers, 11, 22, 33, 44, 55. Assume user has entered five numbers. Okay, but you cannot read all the five numbers at a time and store into this array. Okay, so what your program has to do, your program has to read one by one and store into the array. Okay, so one by one number it has to read and store into the memory location of the array. Okay, so how it reads, now see here using this for loop. Okay, so then control comes to this for loop here. Okay, so what happens, first the initialization will be done, first I is equal to 0, so the memory location of I, 0 will be stored here. Then it checks the condition, then comes to the condition part, I less than 5, what is I value, 0, 0 less than 5, yes, true. Okay, when condition is true, then it goes to the next statement, so executes the scanf statement. Okay, so scanf percentage d. Okay, so then this percentage d, what it will do, it expects one number. So already input is already supplied by the user. So what it will do is, percentage d means single number, the first number it reads. What is the first number? 11 it reads, and where it stores, it stores into num of I. What is I value? 0. Okay, so store in the address of num of 0. So that means in num of 0, this value will be stored. So 11 will be read by this scanf function, and it stores into the memory location of num of 0. Okay, this is how first number will be stored into the array. So after executing this, what happens? Control directly goes to increment section. Control goes to increment section, I plus plus. Okay, so I plus plus, I value will be incremented by, what is I value now? 0. Okay, so now I value becomes a 1 now. Okay, so when this increment section is executed, I value now becomes 1. Okay, so after increment, where it goes, control goes to again to condition part, again it checks the condition. Okay, so this is executed, 1 less than 5, yes, true. Okay, so since it is true, again it executes the scanf function, scanf percentage d. So it reads the second number, Okay, because your input will be in the input buffer. So automatically the pointer will be pointing to the next number. So whenever you say second time scan a percentage D, it reads the second number. Okay, so 22 it reads and stores in num of 1. In num of 1, the second number will be stored. Okay, so after this, where the control goes? Control goes to increment section again, I plus plus. Okay, so when I plus plus is executed, I value will be incremented by 1. Current value is 1. Now I value becomes a 2. Okay. So again, where it goes? Control goes to condition part. Again, checks the condition. This is how the for loop executes. We discussed already. Okay. So I less than 5, what is I value? 2. 2 less than 5? Yes, true. This is executed. True. So then again it goes to scanf function. So whenever you say scanf percentage D, then it reads the next number 33 and stores in num of 2, because I value is 2, num of I we say num of 2 store in the address of num of 2. So 33 will be stored in a num of 2. Okay, so again control goes to increment section, then I value becomes a 3. I value becomes 3. Again checks the condition, 3 less than 5, true. Okay, again executes the scanf function. So percentage D, then it reads the next number. See, it reads 44 and stores in a num of 3. So in num of 3, 44 will be stored. Okay. So again, where it goes? Where it goes? It repeats until the condition becomes false. Okay. Where it goes? It goes to increment part, I plus plus. So I becomes now 4. So again, checks the condition. 4 less than 5, true. So again, executes the scanf function. Percentage D, then reads the next number. Okay, so then store in num of 4. So in num of 4, 55 will be stored. So again, control goes to increment part, I plus plus, I becomes 5. Then checks the condition again, 5 less than 5, false. Now it comes out from the loop. Okay, so then it goes to the statement after the loop. Okay, because there are no statements, that means this is where the control comes. Okay, now using this single for loop and single scanf function, we can read any number of elements into the array, and this is how the for loop reads the numbers entered by the user from the keyboard and stores into the array in this way. Okay, clear? Right? So now this is about declaration of array and assigning values into array. Okay, so having known this, now it is time to write a program. Okay, so already a simple program we have written in the last class, but today I'll write an improved version of that previous program. Okay, so today what we do is we'll write a program to find maximum and minimum elements in an array. Okay, so that means the question will be a list of numbers will be given to you and you need to find out a maximum number and a minimum number. Okay, where we use this program? For example, you are developing an application. Okay, assume that you are developing a college application. Okay, so you have to find out a maximum score and minimum score in a class. Okay, highest number and lowest number. Okay, so we can use this program there. Or you have stored ages of all the students and who is the elder one and who is the younger one, oldest student, okay, and younger one, less age student. Okay, so there we can use this program. Okay, so its applications are many we can use, but only thing is when a list of numbers are given, how to find maximum and minimum number. Okay, so this program will take up, and please remember, when there is a list, you have to use a one-dimensional array. This should come into your mind. Okay. So directly what I do is I open the code blocks. We write the program in code blocks and directly we'll execute that program so that you can understand how a one-dimensional array in program can be used. Okay, so now create an empty file here. Okay, now I am writing the program here. Okay, so what is the first line to be written? Write the comment here, program to find maximum and minimum element, you can say element or number in a list. Okay, in an array, in a list. Okay, so question will be in different forms, but meaning is same. Okay, so what is the next line to be written? Include the header file. Then write the main function. Okay, so let me save this so that you can see different colors. Okay, so I call it as a maxmin dot c. Clear? Okay, now begin the main. So here a list of numbers, a list we need to store. Okay, so that's why we need to declare an array. Okay, so now I am declaring an array of size some 100. Okay, because I do not know initially how many elements I may have in the list, but that's why I am providing it some maximum size. Okay, and how many elements I'll store in a variable called as a n. N is nothing but the actual number of elements in the array. Then I need a loop control variable here. So I am declaring a loop control variable called as a I here. Similarly, I need to store maximum number and minimum number. So for that, I declare two variables, max and min. Okay, so max is a variable which stores maximum value from the list, and min is a variable which stores minimum value from the list. Okay, so that if you print, then you will get maximum and minimum number. Okay, so first create the list. Okay, so ask the user first how many elements he wants to store in the array. Okay, so enter how many elements in the array or in the list, you can write how many elements in the array or in the list. Okay, now read the number here. So say percentage d comma address of n. Okay, so n numbers he wants to store. Now give a message to the user to enter only n numbers. Okay, so how we can write a message here? Enter, for example, user wants to store only 5 numbers. Okay, so then you should get a message, enter 5 numbers. Say he wants to store 10 numbers, then give a message, enter 10 numbers. Okay, so enter 5, 10, the value should be printed. So wherever we want to print the value, then use the format specifier, enter percentage d numbers. Okay, so then supply the variable where from this percentage d should take the value from n. Okay, so it should take the value from n. Okay, so enter percentage d numbers comma n. Okay, so user enters 5 numbers like we have seen in the PPT, 11, 22, 33. Okay, so now we have to read using a for loop. Okay, so for that write a for loop for I is equals to 0. I should start from 0 because array indexing starts from 0. Then I value should be less than size of the array. See here, the size of the array we declared as 100, but we are going to store only n values. Okay, so that's why you have to use I less than n here, not 100. Please remember, you are supplying only n numbers. Okay, so then I plus plus, then say I plus plus. Okay, so now read, because he is entering through keyboard, use scanf function to read the value. So scanf percentage d comma, where to store? Address of num of, what is the way array name? Num of, and index is I. Okay, so because 0, 1, 2, 3 we are creating by using this variable I. Okay, now this loop reads the numbers and stores into the array. Okay, now assume you have numbers stored into the array in this form. you have number stored in the array in this form 11, 22, 30 or some randomly he has entered some numbers, assume that. Okay, so now we need to find out there I entered in a sequence, okay, but generally we enter the numbers randomly, okay, so in some random order we enter the numbers, we do not know where is the smallest number and where is the biggest number in the array, okay. So what I am doing is here now I am considering the first number as the maximum number and also it is the minimum number, okay. So the logic is like this, max is equal to min is equal to, how we can access this first memory location or first element in the array, first element of the array can be accessed using this notation num of 0. Just see here, this is how we can access, okay. So I say that num of 0, the first element itself is the maximum number and the minimum number, okay. Just let me okay, right. So if I have an array with five elements like this, okay, so assume I have an array with five elements in this way. Okay, right. So this is 0th element and this is first element and this is second element, okay, and this is third index and this is fourth index. Okay, I have entered the numbers randomly like this. Okay, so here I entered something like 15. Okay, so here I entered something like 8 I entered. Okay, so here I entered something like 35, okay, or 36 I entered. Okay, so here I entered something like 2 I entered here. Okay, so here I entered something like 24. Randomly I entered the numbers in this way. Okay, so because we can see the numbers, we can tell that this is the minimum number and this is the maximum number. Okay, but computer cannot see these values. Yes or no? Okay, so we need to derive a logic where your computer identifies. As your eyes are doing, the computer, your program should identify the minimum and the maximum value. Okay, so what I am doing is initially I am considering this first number as the minimum value and as the maximum value. Okay, so max is equal to min is equal to, both I am considering this first value. Okay, so I consider max is equal to 15 and also min is equal to 15. Min is equal to also 15 I am considering. Okay, so when this statement is executed, max is equal to min is equal to num of 0. Okay, so that indicates max is equal to 15 and min is equal to 15. Then what I can do? Now I can go on compare with the next number, whether the next number is greater than this. If yes, then that will become the maximum number. Otherwise, I'll go to the next number and again I compare with this. Okay, so like this I go on compare until I reach the last number. That's how I find the maximum number. Similarly, I also compare with the next element and I find out whether the second number is less than this. If this is less than, then this will become the minimum number. Okay, so that's how we should develop the logic here. Okay, so that means from second element onwards we should go on compare the values. Okay, so for that again we need to use a for loop here. Okay, repeatedly you have to use the logic here, compare. Okay, so that's why you should use a for loop here. For I is equals to 1, from second element onwards, see here, from second element onwards you have to compare. So that's why I value should start from a 1. From here, I value should start. Okay. So the logic is for I is equal to 1 and until I less than n, then I plus plus. I plus plus. Okay, right? So now what I am doing is, because more than one comparisons I need to do. First, I try to find out whether if, okay, so I am checking whether the second number is greater than this. Okay, if, how can I access second element location? If num of i is greater than max. If num of I is greater than max, if this is true, that means if the second element is greater than the first number, what is max value? 15. If the second num of I, what is I value? 1. If num of 1 means this number. If this is greater than this, assume something like 28 is here. 28 greater than 15? Yes, true. Assume now, for example, this is 28. Okay, so it compares like this. 28 greater than 15. 28 greater than 15. Yes, if this is yes, then this will become the maximum value. That means now 28 will become the maximum value. Okay, now we have to store 28 in a max. Then max should store 28 now. Okay, how we can do this? Now this should happen. How we can write a statement? Now this 28 now should be stored in the variable max. Okay, so how to write that? When this is true, we can say that the maximum number is equals to num of I. Num of I now will become the maximum value. This is how we can write a statement here. Okay, then max is equal to num of I. Num of I will become the max. Similarly, you check out whether the second number is minimum or not. Instead of writing separate loop, in the same loop, you can check this. If num of i is less than min, okay, so that means I am also checking at the same time. For example, okay, so here it is 8 is there, assume. Okay, so I am rubbing this. Assume the second number, num of I value is 1, no? So num of I, what is I? 1 here. So num of 1 is less than min. What is min value? 15. So 8 is less than 15. Yes. If this is less than, now this will become the minimum value. Yes or no? This will become the minimum value. That means now you have to erase the 15 from this, and now you have to store 8 in the min. You have to store 8 in the min. Okay. So how we can write this in the program? So in program, now if this is true, if num of I is less than min, then min will become num of I. Num of min is equal to num of I. Min is equal to num of I. Num of I itself is the minimum value. That's it. Okay. So then it goes to next statement, I plus plus. What it will do is I plus plus. I will become 2. Okay. Again it checks. Okay. So 36 greater than 28. If yes, then 36 will come here. 36 will come here. Okay. So and similarly, it like this, it compares. 36 is less than 8. No. 36 is less than 8? No. Again, it goes to next element, I plus plus. Okay. So, I becomes now 3 here. Then again, it checks. Okay. So, 2 greater than 36? No. Then it goes to next this here. Okay. So, then again, it checks 2 less than min. 2 is less than 8? Yes. Then 2 will be stored in a min. 2 will be stored in a min. Okay. So, then again, I plus plus, I increments, I will become 4. So, num of 4 greater than max, then it compares. Num of 4 is 24. 24 greater than 36, no, false. When this is false, it is not executed. Directly, it goes to next statement. It comes here. Then again, it checks the condition. Num of 4 less than min, what is num of 4? 24 less than 2, no, false. Okay, so this is also not executed. Then I plus plus, I becomes now 5. I becomes now 5, then 5 less than 5. 5 less than 5, false. Okay, so when this entire loop is repeated, now the maximum value is stored in a variable called as max, and the minimum value is stored in a variable called as a min. Okay, now if you print these two variables, you will get maximum and a minimum value. So that means after coming out from this loop here, you print the values. So printf, now you can say maximum number is equals to percentage d comma max. Where is it? In the variable called as a max. Okay, similarly you print the minimum number, printf, then you say minimum number is equals to percentage d, then say slash n comma min. Where is it? In the variable called as a min. Okay, so close this. Now this is your program. That's it. It prints both maximum and a minimum. Now I'm building. Just quickly I show the execution. Okay, zero errors. Okay, now program. Just see the execution once. Now see on the screen, it says enter how many elements in the array. Okay, so I say 5 elements I want to store. Yeah, it is a bit slow. Yeah, 5. Okay, then enter 5 numbers. So I am entering some numbers randomly, say 15. Okay, so then say 8. Okay, so then say 24. Then say 35. Okay, so then say what else number will enter? Something like 46 will enter. Okay, so then you can see maximum number is equal to 46, minimum number is equal to 8. Okay, so because 46 is maximum and minimum is 8 number. This is how it is printed. Okay, right? So